If there's a certain type of movie adaptation that always fascinated me, it'll have to be the video game adaptations. While there are plenty of them, very few of them are actually considered to be good. Hell, the two obvious examples one would think of for good video game based movies are Detective Pikachu and Sonic the Hedgehog. Both of them are very recent though, and even if they deliver on being fun movies, which I myself very much enjoyed, they aren't masterpieces by any means. The other thing that surprises me is that no matter their quality, or lack thereof, most video game movies don't even turn much of a profit. The two above mentioned examples did well enough, as well as a few others before them, but no video game adaptation really made all that much money, at least compared to the big book or comics adaptations. While debating about this question one day, my eyes fell on the news of a Ghost of Tsushima movie adaptation being in the works, which made me think, wasn't there a Sly Cooper movie being made at some point? The answer is obviously, yes. Yes, there was. But as you can probably tell, or you might even know if you clicked on this video, this movie never saw the light of day. There's a good chance someone else have talked about this story on YouTube before, but you know what? Fuck it. I'm a Sly Cooper fan, and I feel like talking about this damn movie because why the hell not? The year is 2014. Sly Cooper seems to be in the middle of making a comeback in the world of video games after not starring in one since 2005. This started in 2010 when his trilogy got an HD upgrade on the PS3, continued in 2011 where he appeared alongside his PS2 platforming brothers, Jack and Ratchet, in PlayStation Move Heroes, followed by being a playable character in Sony's answer to Super Smash Bros. PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale in 2012, and finally reaching his long-awaited fourth game, Sly Cooper Thieves in Time, in 2013. Not a bad start for a platforming hero's comeback tour, all things considered. So the obvious question now is, what's next? One day, as I was scrolling through my Twitter feed, I suddenly saw a post by PlayStation that Sly Cooper is getting a movie in 2016. The thing which surprised me even more than this sudden announcement is that a trailer debuted the same day, 2 whole years before the movie was even set to be released. To say I was surprised by the out-of-nowhere announcement would have been an understatement, and yet I remember being skeptical of this upcoming movie, but we'll get back to this in a second. What followed the announcement trailer was nothing but silence regarding this movie. In fact, in the same year it was supposed to be released, the writer-director of it, Kevin Monroe, stated that he haven't worked on the project since that announcement trailer. I don't think you need to be a film expert in order to realize that something was up. 2016 came and went, and there was no sign of Sly Cooper in movie theaters. Instead, we got the film adaptation of Ratchet & Clank, also directed by Kevin Monroe. Considering the original release date for that movie was slated for 2015, and then being pushed back, it was safe to assume Sly would just arrive in theaters the next year in 2017, right? Well, there was one problem. Ratchet & Clank bombed at the box office. Say what you will about that movie's quality, it's the money that did the talking, and following that failure, Rainmaker, the company who produced both the Ratchet and Sly adaptations, decided to halt production of the movie. A TV show was announced instead, and then quiet. Again. Noticing a theme here? While the future of Sly Cooper as a franchise remains unknown at this point, why not actually talk about this movie and what my initial thoughts of the entire thing existing were? And to be honest with you, they were pretty mixed. My main reason being that I just think Sly could lend itself to a show better than a movie. Don't get me wrong, a movie adaptation could work in the right hands, but when you really think about it, the games are structured like a TV show, so why not follow that? Each one of the Sly games has an overarching plot, from restoring the TVS Raccoonists, stealing back Clockwork's parts in order to destroy them, getting access to the Cooper Vault, and restoring the Cooper timeline to its original state. However, all of them are split into chapters which are kinda like episodes of a TV show. Even having title screens with chapter names and having structure similar to a TV show episode. Sly and the gang get to a certain part of the world with the main goal in mind, learn a few things about the villain they encounter, discover that something else is going on which happens to connect to their main goal, defeat the villain, on to the next episode until the big climax. If the game you're adapting has a similar structure to a TV show, why not start by making it a TV show? That way you can have more time and opportunities to include what fans would want to see, instead of cramming a 5 hours long game into a less than 2 hours long movie. But you know what, let's give this idea the benefit of the doubt, and see what this movie could have been like, based on the very little information we actually have. The film would have been based on the first game, which is honestly the best direction they could have gone with when it came to bringing Sly Cooper to the big screen. The first game's story is simplistic and easy to get into so that kids could follow it, but also has a style and conflicting ideas about thievery which will keep the adults' attention. While it's unknown if all of the Phineas 5 would have made it into the script, we do know that Clockwork and Carmelita would have made an appearance. Both characters would belong in a film adaptation, as they are important to Sly's story, and would make interesting ideas and relationships pop up. Clockwork, like in the games, would have probably been the biggest enemy of the Cooper family, who's bent on finishing their legacy forever by tearing the TVS Raccoonus apart and ultimately beating Sly. One of the things the games established about the Coopers is that they stole exclusively from other thieves, never the commoners. Clockwork being their archenemy, supposedly objecting to their master thieves mentality, would have made an interesting idea to explore in a film, when the game just kinda skipped that part. What made Clockwork hate the Coopers in the first place? Just how long did this rivalry go for? What made them snap and take such a drastic action towards Sly's father in particular? Again, these are things the games never gave a specific answer to, and would have been interesting things to explore in a movie which would dive deeper into their backstories. Carmelita would have most likely served the same role she served in the games as well, those of the rival to Sly and his love interest. And it's actually right now as I'm typing this script that I realized that their relationship was kind of a precursor to a lot of rivals to lovers relationships which came after. So I guess that trend would have worked in the movie's favor as well. But aside from all of that, Carmelita is also an obstacle for Sly's way of life, and not just because of him being a thief and her being a cop. Sly believes that him being a master thief puts him and his family above the common thief, even making claims that he is stealing things that are wrongfully taken, as if it makes his kind of thievery morally correct and honorable. Carmelita challenges that by sticking to her black and white agenda, which to her, all thieves are the same, no matter who they're stealing from or what their status is. But even with that mindset of hers, she's still willing to join forces with Sly whenever they face a common enemy. While both of those relationships could tell a very interesting story on the big screen, we also need to remember they won't necessarily have been the main focus of the movie. The official premise states that the focus would have been on Sly, Bentley, and Murray building their reputation as the new Cooper gang, and the story would have been about them becoming the big name master thieves that we know from the second game and onward. Again, like the first game. Question is, could all of those plot lines I just described merge together in an hour and a half long movie? While you could say yes, I have a feeling the Clockwork and Carmelita plot lines would have been reduced in order to focus on Sly's journey of following his ancestors. This isn't a bad thing at all, and mind you, I have no idea what the script they were working on was like. Maybe they did find a way to balance it all together and actually give it a longer runtime? At this point, we can only throw guesses regarding what was in the works, but I have a feeling we would have gotten a fairly close adaptation that would add ideas to its themes and would probably cut some of the things that could be left out of the bigger picture. Would it have been good? I am not sure, because I just offered a lot of other ideas that could have been interesting and probably wouldn't have got the full attention they deserve, but when you really look at it, a good adaptation is a good adaptation, even if you could have done a lot more. Now, let's talk about the trailer we actually got. I just want to start by saying that as a trailer for a movie, adaptation or not, familiar with the source material or not, this is actually a pretty good trailer. In fact, I would even compare it to one of those old school Pixar teasers where we'd get a mini plot with the characters from the movie, in the world of the movie, but this sequence in particular won't be featured in it. Kind of like a pilot to sell you the idea of what they're going for. The animation looks great and stylistic, the interactions between the characters is fun, the punchline is entertaining, and it leaves you wanting more. But again, that's assuming you're watching this as a newcomer to the franchise. But the maker of this video isn't a newcomer to the franchise, and there was a point in his life where he played those games more than he drank water, so he had a few complaints that you probably heard if you didn't voice these complaints yourself, and since he's making this video, you're gonna hear them again, because here we go. Let's start with probably the biggest elephant in the room. Why didn't they get Kevin Miller to voice Sly in the trailer? They got Matt Olson and Chris Murphy to reprise Bentley and Murray, then why not get Sly's original voice actor? You know, the main character? Well, the most common answer to that question is that in a movie you're gonna have to cast those A-list celebrities in order to get them mainstream audiences in the seats. Because I'm sure my mother would just have to have watched this movie if George Clooney voiced Sly, doing his George Clooney voice to a talking cartoon animal. I'm not saying there isn't some truth to that statement, but I'm willing to bet plenty of people would have seen this movie regardless if it had celebrity casting or not, if you advertised it enough, and if it had actually interested them. I know this might have been a long shot considering how Ratchet and Clank turned out, but the celebrities you cast in that movie didn't save it from bombing, so with all due respect, get Sly his actual voice actor, because that way you're making the fans, your core audience, happy. And hey, if Carmelita was in fact supposed to be in this movie, why not get a celebrity to voice her? Her voice changed in every game to the point it's a running gag, so it's not like you'd hurt someone over that character having a different voice. Also, I may have been able to buy that A-list celebrity thing if the guy who voiced Sly in the trailer was an actual celebrity. No offense to Ian James Collett, who voiced many great characters in his career, but let's be honest, his name ain't going to put people unfamiliar with Sly Cooper in the seats. Many have also claimed that the casting in the trailer wasn't final and could have been changed, which made the recasting even worse, since why not just get Kevin Miller to do it? I know it might be nitpicking to some of the people watching this, but you have to understand that as a fan of this franchise, I'm getting a bunch of mixed signals from this whole fiasco. And this doesn't stop with just the voice cast, as we are moving on to the animation. While I would have preferred a 2D animated movie for Sly Cooper, as the games are known for their cel-shaded graphics and comic book appearance, I get going with a complete CG look for the animation, because let's be real, 2D animation is slowly dying in theaters lately, as painful as it is to admit. And while it's not my go-to look for a Sly movie, it does capture this noir vibe that the games went for. So not much complaints though. The character designs though! Again, the maker stated that the reason they changed the character designs was because of the switch from 2D-like style to a fully 3D one, which I'd call bullshit on, since PlayStation Move Heroes put Sly and Bentley in the same 3D world of Ratchet and Clank and Jack and Daxter, and they work just fine without drastically changing their designs. So what's the film's excuse? When it comes to the character designs themselves, Bentley is the best looking one. If you had to redesign him in any way, I'd say it's the best they could have done, considering he looks close enough to his original design, just that his glasses actually allow you to see his eyes. Sly looks similar enough to his original counterpart, but I don't know, that face looks incredibly off to me. Not to mention he looks like Shrek's Puss in Boots. I can't be the only one seeing this, can I? I know Sly is the smooth and sarcastic leader, but I get the sarcastic with his face, not much the smooth. Murray, on the other hand, good god, why? Just look at this design and the OG next to each other. Would you have even guessed that these two are the same character with no prior context? This is the only one I'm having problems accepting though, and the rest of the characters had no official designs revealed, so can't comment on those. And this pretty much sums it up. Nothing else has been made known about this movie, and it will probably never be released, so that's all I can say about it. Am I happy that this movie never got to see the light of day, considering I was pretty critical of it just now? Honestly, no. While my impressions from this trailer weren't the best, I can't say I wouldn't have given this movie its fair shot if it were to see the light of day. Some movies I was looking forward to based on franchises I liked ended up being disappointing, and some which I was sure were going to be dumpster fires ended up being great. So who knows where the Sly Cooper movie would have landed. At the time of writing this script, there's no new info about the Sly TV show, which is in production, kinda. If you want my quick thoughts on it, I'm interested, but I also don't have anything to go on in order to judge. I have to actually see something in order to, you know, judge it. Considering the state this franchise has been in for the past 8 years, I would gladly take anything which would allow me to go on one more thieving adventure with this master thief. But as of right now, who knows when that will ever be. Also, for the love of God, Sony, make a Sly 5 and close that super cliffhanger from Thieves in Time. Okay, thanks, bye!